Good morning. It's great to see everybody. I tell you what, why don't you stand, find somebody around that you haven't got to speak with just yet, and welcome each other for the next couple of seconds. Okay, we have a lot to cover this morning. We had better get after it. Let's begin our time together by singing 571. Trust and obey. Trust and obey. Here we go.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to First Christian Church. We're excited this morning to have Answers in Genesis with us, and we're looking forward to everything they've got today and tomorrow. We have a full day tomorrow as well. If you're visiting with us, we do have some communion cups out in the back, and so when we have communion later on, that is what we'll be using. So if you haven't grabbed one of those yet, please do so. I've just got a couple announcements this morning, and just if you are visiting with us, we've got this connection card that's a tear out in the bulletin, and so if you would just fill that out and fill that out, that's a way for us to connect with you and get you connected with everything we have here at First Christian. And also, if you have any prayer requests or you need to update any information with the church office, you can do so right there. As Pastor Matt said, we have a busy morning, so I'm not going to take up too much of your time, but would you join me in prayer as we continue on in worship? Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather in your house this morning, and I pray that as we hear from our friends with Answers in Genesis, that we would be encouraged with everything that we hear this morning, God, and it would draw us closer to you. We pray that we worship you as we worship you through song and through looking into your word, that you would already open up our hearts and our minds to what you have to say so that we can leave this place better prepared to share the good news of Jesus with all those that we come in contact with. And Father, now we come to you and we pray as you have taught your disciples to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's continue our time together by singing hymn 408, How Firm a Foundation. Let's stand together. Looks up to thee, O Lamb of Calvary. Let's sing hymn 539.
Morning, church family. As we gather here to take this communion, I would like to let everyone know, if you're a guest here with us today, we practice open communion, which we recognize this to be the Lord's table and not ours. So if you're a guest here with us here today, we invite you to please share in this communion with us. As we prepare to do so, I'd like to reflect on Paul's words. Apostle Paul, he writes in 1 Corinthians about the significance of how we take communion. He gives us an example by illustrating the proper way to do so, by illustrating the scene in that upper room where Jesus was surrounded by his disciples on the night before he was crucified. In chapter 11, verse 23, Paul writes that on the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you do so in remembrance of me." In verse 26, he concludes by writing, "For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you so much for this Lord's Day that you've given us and for all the blessings that you've given us, for we know that everything we have in this world comes directly from you. Father, our gratitude is indescribable for the gift of your Son, Jesus, and for the sacrifice that he made for us. And as we take of this bread representing his broken body and this cup symbolizing his spilled blood, I pray that we would do so in a manner which you would find proper, that we would every day remember the sacrifice that he's made for us, and that we would share the good news of his sacrifice with everyone with whom we come in contact who's not yet heard it, expanding your kingdom here on earth and fulfilling the charge that you've given to each of us as disciples. All these things we ask in your Son's most holy name. Amen.
It's been a very enjoyable time teaching you over the last month, Christ the Sure and Steady Anchor. I hope that you've enjoyed the hymn as much that I have. Let us ponder these thoughts of this song as we sing it one last time this month, Christ the Sure and Steady Anchor. Let's sing, stand together.
I will hold fast to the anchor.
Christ the shore. Christ the shore of our salvation.
Well, good morning, church family. We're taking a break from our Nehemiah series because we have a special guest with us today. We're very blessed to have Answers in Genesis representative with us. We planned this probably 5 months ago, if memory serves me correctly. How many of you were here 2 years ago when we had Tommy Mitchell speak? Anybody here for that one? Very good. Some enthusiastic hands are going up. And just out of curiosity, how many of you have visited the Ark? Gone to Kentucky to see the Ark experience? Great. And now the only other question I had, because I'm very curious, how many of you have gone to see the Ark since you heard Tommy Mitchell speak? Many people gone out just to, because we had Tommy come out. Brian Osborne has been with Answers in Genesis for 7 years. He has traveled the globe preaching truth from the Word of God. And we're so honored to have him here. His story is, his testimony is remarkable in how he got into that ministry. And he is from High Point, North Carolina, is where he originated, and that too is where my wife is from. So we had some stories to swap last night. They were rival high schools back in the day, I believe. But Brian's going to come up and take us to about a quarter after the hour. He's going to speak for an hour. And so today we're going to go into overtime. And just as I've said before, whenever your game's going to overtime, you're really excited, right? And you tell your friends the next day, well, church is going into overtime today. So let's give Brian a big hand and welcome him to the stage.
Good morning. You guys are awake. Awesome. Praise the Lord. It is so good to be here with you in Texas. It's good to meet a fellow High Pointian. I don't know what you call us, all right? But it's so neat to make that connection. It's so neat to see that many of you remember Dr. Tommy Mitchell, who visited roughly 2 years ago. You may know that he has passed away since. He was a dear friend of mine, a mentor in many ways, and I appreciate your prayers for him and his family and his wife as they continue to kind of mourn through that. But it's an honor to kind of come in his footsteps and follow up behind Tommy. He brings back so many good memories for me. It's just a blessing to be here with you. It's a blessing to see the body of Christ around the world, and especially here in Texas. It's so good on multiple levels. But again, from the Ministry of Answers in Genesis, before I dive into all that, first, I will show you my greatest earthly blessings. They're on the screen right there, all right? That's my wife, Marla, of 23 years this past June. My son, Ian, who is 7. My daughter, Macy, who is 3. And I just like showing them off, so that's my family, all right? And they are missing me right now, and I'm missing them, but I just love looking at them. So there you go. And then more pictures of my kids because I like showing off my kids. And that's us in Australia and just different pictures and so forth. And I've been with the ministry for 7 years. Before joining Answers in Genesis, I was a teacher. I taught for 13 years in a public high school in Tennessee. I had the privilege of teaching Bible history in a public school. Which is a very unique setting. Did that for 13 years. My wife was a teacher as well, so we love teachers in our household. And then God called me to the Ministry of Answers in Genesis roughly, again, 7 years ago. And really this morning what we're going to do is kind of lay down the why of the ministry, the why we do what we do, why this issue of apologetics and defending the faith from the beginning is so relevant and is so important. Because our ministry is an apologetics ministry, and that doesn't mean we're equipping people to apologize for their faith. Rather, we're teaching Christians to defend their faith, to stand boldly on God's word, to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ from the very first verse, to stand uncompromisingly on the word of God, as we're commanded to in God's word in multiple places, to give an answer for the reason for the hope that is in us. And we do this in multiple ways as a ministry, as Pastor already mentioned. We have the Creation Museum and the Ark Encounter over in northern Kentucky. So if you've not been, I would so encourage you to go. I know it's a bit of a drive from here, all right, or a flight or whatnot, but it is so worth it. The Creation Museum, part of our ministry, a 75,000 square foot walk through biblical history. And as we walk you through that biblical history, we're answering the skeptical questions of this age. If the Bible's true, what about evolution? What about the age of the earth? What about dinosaurs in the Bible? What about Noah's Ark and flood? And where did the water for the flood go? And where did it come from? And how did Noah get all the animals onto the ark? And what about all these different things we hear about the ape men, etc.? And we give good answers. And it's an amazing experience. Again, so much to see. There's a 4D special effects theater. There's a planetarium that is world class. We've got botanical gardens that are gorgeous. We got playgrounds for the kids. You can spend a good full 2 days at the Creation Museum. You really can. There's zip line courses. If you don't like life, you can check those out. Those are great. They're safe. All right. But you can check out all that stuff. It's so much fun. And it's so much to take in. If you read even just a third of what is there, you can spend a good 2 days taking in the content at the Creation Museum. So I encourage you to check that out. But that's part of our ministry. And another part, as Pastor mentioned, is the Ark Encounter. If you heard about those crazy people in Kentucky who built Noah's Ark, that is us, all right, the Ministry of Answers in Genesis, a life-size replica of Noah's Ark. The real-life dimensions, over 500 feet long and 85 feet wide and 50 feet tall with three different levels, just like we find in God's Word. It's a really big boat. And so you go inside. To me, honestly, the inside of the Ark is more impressive than the outside. I mean, the size is unbelievable, but once you get on the inside, the architecture, the size, the scale, the exhibits, the artistry, it is so well done. We say often that the attractions, the museum and the Ark Encounter, they are first class, they are world class, because God has brought some amazingly talented people to the ministry who have used their skills in artistry and making sculptures and doing paintings and writing the exhibits. They do a fantastic job. It'll blow you away, just the quality of it. And oh, by the way, you'll hear the gospel again and again and again as you go throughout the attractions. You really will. If you get a chance, you want to check that out. There's zoos at both locations. We got kangaroos, we got lemurs, all sorts of stuff in the zoos, camels you can ride if you want to do that. Botanical gardens or gardens at the Ark Encounter as well. You can spend a good full day at the Ark Encounter. And at both attractions, we have speakers daily. Myself, other speakers, Ken Ham, the founder, will speak at the attractions on different topics. We have different events going on, people who sing. There's so much to do. You can spend a good 2 days at the museum, a good day or two at the Ark if you're trying to plan for that. I really encourage you to check that out. That's in Northern Kentucky, right below Cincinnati, if you're curious and looking into that. But again, this morning, what we'll do is we're going to lay down the why. Why are we so passionate about this stuff as a ministry that we've built the Ark Encounter and the Creation Museum? We have thousands of books and DVDs, all these resources. We send speakers around the world. Why does this matter so much? We're going to lay that foundation. And we're going to cover some of the answers more specifically in the coming sessions. Tonight, we'll talk about evolution. Is evolution actually real? And define those terms. We'll talk about the ape man and really get into that. Tomorrow night, we'll talk about one blood, one race. And then tomorrow night, we're going to give quick biblical answers to the social issues of our day. How do we biblically respond to the issue of homosexuality or the transgender movement or climate change or social justice and those sorts of ideas, and quick biblical answers to that? So we're going to get to a lot of the answers, but again, this morning is really the why. And I'll say first off that as a ministry, we are so passionate about this stuff because we've recognized something that I bet you guys have recognized. We've recognized our nation is going in the wrong direction. Have you noticed that? Like, that's not hard to see, right? That's pretty straightforward. With that, we're seeing the collapse of the Christian worldview happening in America. But it's not just in America. We're seeing the Christian worldview collapse across the entire Western world. But the fact that it's happening here in America is astounding. Because if you think about it, we are probably the most Christianized nation ever. I mean, we have more Bible colleges than anybody else in the world, more seminaries. We have over 600,000 churches in America. We have more Christian resources and bookshops and radio stations and television stations. We have more Christian resources than any nation has ever had in all of history. Isn't that a wild thought? But for all those Christian resources, are we becoming more or less Christian every day? What's the answer? Less, and rapidly so. Newsweek back in 2009 said it well on the cover, The Decline and Fall of Christian America. And inside they said this: the present in this sense, it's less about the death of God, and it's more about the birth of many gods. We used to be one nation under God, but now we're one nation under many gods. Isn't it great? See how tolerant we are? But in truth, at a foundational level, did you realize there are actually only two religions? People say two? Just two. Here they are. Either God's word is your foundation and you build your thinking from there, or reject God's word. And in that case, man's word in some way, shape, or form becomes your ultimate authority. Those are your two foundational religions: God's word versus man's. And what we've seen in our culture has been a foundational shift in much of our cultural thinking away from God's word to man's word has become the ultimate authority. Man now determines what is truth. And that, by the way, is why truth is relative in our culture today, because each person decides their own truth with themselves as their own ultimate center, their own God. A lie as well as Genesis chapter 3. And that's why our culture looks a lot like Judges 21:25. When there was no king in Israel, every man did that which is right in his own eyes. And doesn't that sound like our culture today? And that's why we see headlines like this one, permeating our culture. Drag queen story hour brings pride and glamour to libraries across the U.S. Or headlines like this one, head of drag queen story hour arrested for child pornography. Who'd have thunk it? Headlines like this one, California proposes curriculum with chanting name of Aztec God who accepts human sacrifice, you know, to decolonize the kids and make them less white in our oppressive society. Or we're being told today by the medical establishment and by many other political leaders, don't call expectant mothers pregnant women, call them pregnant people, because, you know, today everybody can be pregnant. It's the idea. There's a father in Canada who was put in jail for calling his daughter, because she identifies as a different gender, and they arrested him for doing that. Or Democratic Representative Jerry Nadler, he said, in talking about the Equality Act in Congress, that God's will is of no concern to us here in Congress. And you can tell by their actions that seems to be the case most often. Or we're told by Coca-Cola and many other very big organizations that we need to train our employees to be less white because white is bad, because white is oppressive, according to critical race theory ideology permeating our culture today. Or TEDx speaker says pedophilia is a natural sexual orientation. That argument's growing in intensity in the world, in our culture, in the Western culture. Of course, abortion being legalized throughout, basically to the point of birth in places like New York and many other places, basically legalized infanticide, murdering people. And polyamory is being legalized in Massachusetts, headlines showing that. We're seeing these headlines. I'll give you a second for this one, but I'll read it and you just take it in. 61-year-old woman gives birth to own granddaughter for a gay son using his husband's sister's egg. And then one more just for good measure, just show how insane we are today. Transgender man gives birth to non-binary partner's baby with female sperm donor. I could go on, but can we agree just for the sake of time, our culture has lost its mind. We recognize that. The question we have is why? And I think a better way to word that question is this. Why isn't the church, why aren't Christians influencing the culture like we used to? Think back to like Billy Graham today. And guys, here's what we suggest. We're not influencing the culture. Why? Because in so many cases today, it's the culture influencing the church. That many Christians have compromised God's word in different areas. We've undermined biblical authority. As a result, we're seeing the collapse of the Christian worldview. That what has taken place has been an attack on the word of God. Yes, outside the church, but also inside the church. And the results have been catastrophic. And the fact that God's word has been under attack, that's not new. God's word has been under attack since Genesis chapter 3. Remember? When the devil said to Eve, "Did God really say?" Notice what he was doing, getting Eve to question God's word, to doubt God's word, so ultimately she would reject it. And the method was so effective, he's used that same method ever since. Different forms, but same basic attack. And one of the main ways he's doing this today is through the teaching of things like evolution and ape men, a big bang, and especially millions of years, using those sort of secular ideas to get multiple generations to watch this, question God's word, doubt God's word, to reject God's word. Same basic attack. But today he's doing it in a stealthy way, because notice what he's doing. Today he's attacking the Bible's history to undermine the Bible's authority, to undermine the gospel rooted in that authority. Because here's the bottom line. If you cannot trust the Bible's history, why on earth trust it about morality or salvation? Makes sense, right? If you can't believe Genesis 1, why would you trust John chapter 3? If you cannot believe the beginning of this book, why trust the middle or the end? And for so many people today, this is their stumbling block to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And guys, the secularists, they understand this well. They understand that a great way to attack biblical authority is to attack the Bible's history and thus undermine that authority from the beginning. If you want an example of this, I'm going to show you a clip of this guy. His name is Dr. Lawrence Krauss, professor of physics at Arizona State University. The clip is from 2009. I want you to hear what he says to a group of students, hear their reaction, and then as you do, bear in mind this is just a good example of kind of how the attack is really happening in a big way in our culture today.
The amazing thing is that every atom in your body came from a star that exploded. And the atoms in your left hand probably came from a different star than your right hand. It really is the most poetic thing I know about physics. You are all stardust. You couldn't be here if stars hadn't exploded, because the elements, the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, iron, all the things that matter for evolution, weren't created at the beginning of time. They're created in the nuclear furnaces of stars, and the only way they can get into your body is if the stars were kind enough to explode. So forget Jesus. The stars died so that you could be here today. Okay? And anyway, this is great.
Forget Jesus. The stars died so you can be here today. Forget Jesus. He's not your Savior God. Why? He's not your Creator God. You're not here because God made you like the Bible says. You're here because stars exploded. Basically, he's saying this. The Bible's wrong about your origins, the beginning, where you come from. It's wrong about morality and salvation as well. If you can't trust the beginning, why trust the Bible anywhere else? And this same guy said later on at a different conference that change is always one generation away. So he said, if we can plant the seeds of doubt in our children, which sounds a lot like Genesis chapter 3, did God really say? Religion, he really means Christianity, will go away in a generation, or at least largely go away. And that's what I think we, the intellectual elites, have an obligation to do. Thank goodness he's neutral. No such thing, right? We'll come back to that later on. But he is right about one thing. Change is always one generation away. We see it in God's word numerous times. We see it happening right before our very eyes. According to multiple surveys, multiple studies now for decades, guys, an average of around 2/3 of kids today who grew up in Christian-going homes are walking away from the church by the time they reach college age, most of whom today do not return. We're talking about kids who grew up in a Christian setting. And so most of those are walking away, so we wanted to find out why and what to do about it. So we did a research project with America's Research Group. We interviewed 1,000 of these millennials who have grown up in the church and since walked away to try to figure out what's going on and what to do about it. And let me just show you two of the major findings that are pretty helpful in understanding what's happening. First, when they interviewed those who had grown up in church and walked away, they asked them, if you don't believe, when did you first have doubts? And please notice, it was not college. Isn't that what we tend to think? Our kids, they seem fine while they're with us here. They grow up in the church, they seem fine. Then they go off to the secular universities, and people like Lawrence Krauss, the guy you just saw, well, he changes their minds, and then they walk away, and all the peer pressure and temptation of sin, that's when they walk away, right? According to research, they had all these questions, all these doubts, starting really in middle school and high school. Over 80% had all these doubts starting in middle school and high school. They had all these questions that were not getting answered, at least not at home and not at church. What sort of questions? Well, the same questions I heard for 20 years working with youth in the church, 13 years teaching Bible history in a public school. Questions like, if the Bible's true, then where did God come from? And how do you know the Bible is the Word of God? Why not the Quran? And by the way, who did Cain marry? And hasn't science disproved the Bible? Doesn't evolution disprove the Bible? And by the way, aren't the rock layers and fossils millions of years old? Doesn't that disprove the Bible? And Noah's flood, how did Noah get all those animals onto the ark? And where did the water from the flood go? And by the way, what about carbon-14 dating and radiometric dating? Doesn't that disprove the Bible? What about dinosaurs? They lived millions of years ago, right? Doesn't that disprove the Bible? Why is there so much death and suffering in this world? Doesn't that disprove the Bible? Have you heard some of those? Maybe not that fast, but we hear them. Why? Because this is primarily where the attack is happening today. You see, for so many in this quote-unquote scientific age, they believe the Bible has been bombed out by these sort of ideas. It's been undermined, and they're looking for answers. Hey, if the Bible is true, then what about these issues? What are the answers? Give me a good biblical answer. And guys, they're coming to us for answers. They're coming to their Christian parents. They're coming to their Christian grandparents. They're coming to their Christian friends. They're coming to people they know who believe in Christianity. The Bible's true, then what about all these saints? They're coming to us for answers. And guys, what has been our response in general for almost a couple centuries now to these sorts of questions? We've been saying something like this, you know what? I don't know about the rock layers or the fossils or evolution or distant starlight or radiometric dating or all that stuff, but don't worry about that stuff. Just trust in Jesus. Now, let's be really clear. We want them to trust in Jesus. Amen? Amen? Christian church, very good. All right. No. Of course we want them to trust in Jesus, but hear me, when we ignore their questions and we just say that, we're ignoring their fundamental question, which is this. Here's what they're asking. Why should I trust in your Jesus? Because the message of salvation through Christ alone, that message comes from where? And dear mom, dad, grandpa, if I can't believe this part over here, why should I trust the rest? Ultimately, either all of this book is authoritative and true or none of it is. And you see, for so many, according to research, they're walking away in their hearts and minds before they ever leave physically for college. They're sitting in our pews, in our homes right now, and they're already gone. That's why we entitled the book with the research, Already Gone. And we also asked them in the research, well, their reasons for leaving, one of their main reasons for leaving was hypocrisy. And we said, okay, kind of figured, but define that for us. What do you mean by hypocrisy? And this is what the majority said on their own. This was not multiple choice. They said something along these lines. They said, well, we grew up in church, and we were told in church that this book, the Bible, it is the very word of God. Trust what it says, especially that bit about Jesus. But then they said they were told in some way, shape, or form by a parent, a grandparent, pastor, friend, that someone, that we as Christians, we don't really necessarily believe this part of the book. And you can take evolution and ape men, Big Bang, millions of years. You can take man's ideas, reinterpret this first part. It's not that important. Just be sure you believe the rest of it. I literally just read an article yesterday where Dr. William Lane Craig basically said that exact thing. Many Christians are saying that. You can reinterpret this part with man's ideas. Don't worry about that part. You don't have to believe that. Just be sure you believe the rest of it. Guys, I see it as hypocrisy, and rightfully so, because that is what it is. And because that sort of compromise, we're seeing so many testimonies like this young man's.
Of how I became an atheist. I was born into a Christian family and indoctrinated as growing up as a kid. That next year was freshman year of high school, and I started learning about evolution in my biology class. Then that's where I realized I had never seriously questioned or thought about my religious beliefs. So as I learned about evolution and just started thinking philosophically about it, I realized that there couldn't be a God. So I became an atheist.
And I'm willing to bet that most people in this room know someone with a similar testimony as that young man's, because it is so common in our day and age. And the news for Generation Z is getting worse, not better. Generation Z, the newest generation, they are twice as likely as any previous generation to confess atheism as their worldview. George Barna recently called Generation Z, these are basically 13 to 18-year-olds today, they call them the first truly post-Christian generation in America. I could go on with those stats, but we're just seeing the collapse in so many ways. And guys, hear me. I'm sure that maybe many of you, like myself, for the longest time, we've had the best of intentions when we said, I don't know about that stuff. Don't worry about it. Trust in Jesus. We had really good intentions. But can't we as Christians, even as Christians, have good intentions but still get really terrible consequences? It's possible, right? Now, I know this is a really kind of heavy talk, especially early on a Sunday morning. So let me give you a lighthearted example of when Christians have had good intentions but got bad consequences. Let me show you some bad church bulletin titles that really kind of drive home the point. You might relate to just a bit. Bulletin titles like this one. The peacemaking meeting scheduled for today has been canceled due to a conflict. Could have been worded a bit better, right? Or this one. Don't let worry kill you off. Let the church help. Which, is that done by committee? I don't know. Okay, anyway. At the service tonight, the sermon topic will be, what is hell? Come early, listen to our choir practice. And then the last one here. Barbara remains in the hospital. She's having trouble sleeping and requests tapes of Pastor Jack's sermons. Yeah, right? Good intentions, bad consequences. And guys, on a serious note, when we as Christians try to squeeze man's ideas into God's word, even with the best of intentions, you'll get the worst of consequences. And we see these consequences all around us right now. And we also saw in the research that the way we are teaching the Bible is causing many to struggle or doubt it. You say, what do you mean? Well, so often, when you go to a Bible study, especially for kids, but not just kids, you go to a Bible study, Sunday school classroom or whatever, and oftentimes we will say, hey, today we're going to study this great Bible story. But what does the word story tend to mean in our modern vernacular? Yeah, fiction, fairy tale, not true, right? That's what it tends to come across. And so, especially for kids, they hear story, they think story time, fairy tale, not real history, maybe a moral point or a philosophical point, but not really connected to reality per se. And then we show our kids pictures like this of Noah's Ark as an overloaded bathtub, right? With drafts coming out top of some sort of chimney on the ark, right? Monkeys hanging on the porthole. These pictures disturb me. Why? Because typically on these pictures, everybody's smiling and happy, even though the whole world is being destroyed. Doesn't make sense to me, all right? And I get the point of the picture. I know it's meant to be, you know, engaging for kids, but kids are very impressionable. You show a kid a picture like that. Does that tell that child Noah's Ark and flood, real event in history, or fairy tale? Fairy tale. And we're reinforcing a secular idea whether we mean to or not. You see, for our kids, and not just our kids, but for so many people today, they've got all these questions. They're being bombarded with from so many different angles in our culture, whether it's at school, when you go to a zoo or museum, or just when you watch TV or when you listen to music, go on social media, go to YouTube, wherever, all these ideas are bombarding them. They're looking for answers. And for the most part, we are not giving them any. We're just teaching them stories. And for the most part, in Christianity, in our churches, in our Christian homes, we are not doing apologetics. For the most part, we've not equipped ourselves or the coming generations to know what we believe and why to defend the faith. We're just teaching stories. So where do they go to get the answers? Well, basically the only other alternative, which are secular sources. They go to their secular textbooks. They go to zoos. They go to museums. They go to Uncle Google. They go to YouTube, they go to Facebook, they go to their secular friends, secular teachers, and they learn about the real history of the universe, quote unquote. They learn about evolution in millions of years. Really what they're learning, think about it. They're learning secular apologetics. They're learning all the reasons the Bible must not be true and cannot be trusted. What are they learning at church? Stories. And when you think about it like that, it's not so surprising that so many are walking away. And guys, that history in Genesis, it's not a fairy tale. It is real history, and it is really important. And we summarize that history at the ministry with what we call the seven C's of history. If you went to the Ark of the Museum, you most likely saw these. The first four C's, creation, corruption, catastrophe, confusion, that is Genesis 1 to 11. That's the geological, biological, anthropological, astronomical history of the universe that lays the foundation for the last three C's, which is Christ's cross and consummation. Summary of the gospel and Christ's return. I like to say these seven C's, they are married and they cannot be divorced. A few quick examples. Just as it was originally in the original creation, there was originally no death, no suffering, no bloodshed, no disease. It was perfect. Someday when Christ returns at the consummation, he will make it perfect again. Who's looking forward to that? Amen, right? And then the second C, the corruption, because a real man in real history, our real representative head, he really did sin, and we all really do descend from that man. That's why we are all sinners by nature and consequently by choice, and we all need saving through the last Adam, Jesus Christ. God, who became flesh, part of the human race, part of our blood, he lived the perfect life. He died on the cross in our place, taking God's wrath on our behalf. He died and rose from the grave, defeating death. If you repent and put your faith in him, you will be saved. And then the catastrophe, the flood of Noah's day, think about it. It was a global judgment on man's sin, a global righteous, holy judgment on man's sin. But there was one way to be saved through the door of the ark, the only way of salvation. That's a picture of Jesus Christ, because there's another global judgment coming. The next time, it is by fire and for eternity. And Jesus said, I am the door. If by me any man enter in, he shall be saved. In John 14:6, Jesus declared, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. The ark is a picture of Christ. And then the confusion, the Tower of Babel. We'll talk a whole lot more about this later on tonight and tomorrow night. But it reminds us that actually all people today can trace their family trees back to Noah and his sons. Before that, every person who has ever lived can trace their family tree back to one man and one woman, Adam and Eve. That means, biblically speaking, supported by real science, by the way, how many races are there? One, the human race. And again, since we all descend from Adam, that's why we're all sinners in need of saving through the last Adam, Jesus Christ. See that quick connection to the gospel. But again, if that first part is not true, like the culture is saying, like much of the church is agreeing, then why should we trust the West? I mean, you'll say, okay, Brian, I understand that. That point makes sense. But come on, buddy, it's just Genesis. It can't be that important. And I will suggest to you that's what the devil wants you to believe. Because if you map this out, pretty much every single biblical doctrine, either directly or indirectly, finds its foundation, its root in that history of the book of Genesis, in particular Genesis 1 to 11. A few quick examples. Where do we see the origin of marriage? That comes from the book of Genesis, right? Where do we see the origin of sin and death? We see that in the book of Genesis. Why do we practice a seven-day week? That comes from the book of Genesis, right? And that only comes from Genesis, by the way. No astronomical marker for a seven-day week. That only comes from the Bible, and it works best that way. Why do we wear clothes? I noticed that you are, and that is good. Amen? That goes back to the book of Genesis. How do we know there are only two fundamental genders? That goes back to the book of Genesis. How do we know that every single human life, no matter where it lives, in the womb or on the moon, no matter their skin shade, their eye shape so-called, their ethnicity, their accent, every human life has inherent and indelible value because it's made in the image of the living God. That's found in the book of that history in Genesis 1 to 11. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Why is he called the last Adam? Why do we need a new heavens and a new earth? That all goes back to the book of Genesis, foundation for every single biblical doctrine. You take away that foundation, the whole structure will collapse. I heard someone recently very cleverly say that if God thought Genesis was so important, he should have put it closer to the beginning of the book. It's the first book for a reason, right? And let me give you two quick examples of biblical doctrines being attacked by attacking that history in the book of Genesis. The doctrine of marriage. I think we can all agree pretty easily this doctrine is under assault in America and throughout the world. And it's interesting, when Jesus was asked about marriage, he did something radical. He quoted the Bible as his authority. And he said to the Pharisees, when they asked about marriage and divorce, and he said to them, have you not read, translation, don't you guys read your Bible? Like the first book of the Bible, the first chapter, that he who made them from the beginning, made them male and female. They're your two genders. And said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. And he's showing that the doctrine of marriage is based on the biology and the history of Genesis being true. You become one in marriage. Why? It's based on the historical, biological fact that the woman came from the man, like the Bible clearly describes from cover to cover. The woman came from the man. The woman, praise God, did not come from the ape woman. Amen, fellas? Double amen. Praise God. All right, yeah. She came from the man. And you know what? As Christians, we can say boldly, lovingly, uncompromisingly, that marriage is between one man, one woman for life. Why? Because the God who made marriage made it between one man, one woman for life. Guys, God made it. He defines what it is. And we find that in the book of Genesis. But again, if that history is not true and or God's word is not the authority, then why not redefine marriage and make it whatever you want it to be? Which is what our culture is doing right now. But again, that one's pretty easy to see. Let me show you a different one that's a bit more subtle but just as important in a different way. The doctrine of death and its relationship to Christ's atoning work on the cross is also under assault. You see, what do you mean? Follow me on this. You see, the Bible is very clear that in the beginning, God made a perfect creation. Originally, there was no death, no suffering, no bloodshed, no disease. It was perfection. And God warned Adam, the day you eat of the fruit, you will surely die as a consequence. And the Bible is clear from one end to the other that it was man's sin that brought death, the enemy, into God's perfect creation. We wrecked God's perfect creation with our sin. The wages of sin is death. Romans 8:22 tells it like this, that the whole of creation is groaning in pain because of man's sin. It's broken because of our sin. It's groaning in pain because of our sin. And it's longing for when Christ returns and returns it all back to its original perfect state. We see in the Bible the first death of an animal after Adam sinned. God kills an animal. He sheds its blood, the first real blood sacrifice, to make clothing for Adam and Eve to cover their sin and their shame. Of course, that's a picture of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who comes later and sheds his blood to cover our sin and our shame. And most would say, okay, Brian, we're with you in all of that, but where's the attack? Here it is. If you try to squeeze the secular atheistic idea of millions of years into the Bible, no matter how you try, no matter what good intentions you might have, you'll inevitably put death before sin. And death before sin is theologically impossible for a bunch of reasons. Here are a couple quick ones. First, in Genesis 1:29 and 30, in the original perfect creation, God told Adam and Eve they were to eat fruit, the animals were to eat plants. Originally, all things were vegetarian, which I know sounds weird to us today, but it makes really good biblical sense because there was no death in this world until after Adam sinned. Which means you cannot eat meat until after Adam sinned. Because when you eat meat, you're eating something that has died. Before sin, there's no death. Everything has to be vegetarian. It makes really good biblical sense. Not until after the flood that God told Noah, just as it gave you plans to eat, Noah, now you can eat everything. And this is the reason you can eat a hot dog, because it is everything. That's our standard ministry joke right there, okay? But people say, well, why is that a problem? Well, here's why. If you reject the Bible's clear teaching and its implications, that God made a perfect creation, but then man sinned, bringing death into the world, and then there was a global flood that laid down most of the rock layers and fossils we see today, if you reject that and you instead embrace the secular idea that the rock layers and fossils, well, weren't they laid down slowly over millions of years? Watch this. Long before man ever existed, and thus before sin, in those rock layers supposedly laid down before man, before sin, we find lots of evidence of animals eating each other. But the Bible says before man sinned, all things were vegetarian. We find in that same fossil record lots and lots of evidence of diseases, things like brain tumors, cancer, and arthritis, and many others, all the way through the rock record. But before man sinned? The Bible says God looked down on day six before man sinned and called everything very good. Surely God would not call millions of years of death, suffering, bloodshed, cancer very good. If he did, that would not be a very good God. And by the way, think about it. If this were true, it makes God the author of death. It was part of his original very good creation. If this were true, he used death as part of his creative process over millions of years. In a real sense, by embracing millions of years, we're blaming God for death instead of our sin. We find thorns on the fossil record, supposedly millions of years old, but the Bible's clear thorns came after the curse, right? They're a result of the curse. They're a symbol of the curse. And that's why Christ on the cross wore the crown of thorns. He bore the curse on our behalf. And then most important of all, if you try to squeeze millions of years into the Bible, does not matter how you try, day-age theory, gap theory, progressive creation, theistic evolution, framework hypothesis, cosmic temple, etc., they all put death before sin. And watch this logically and theologically. If there was death before sin, that would mean death is not the consequence or the payment for sin. Just always been around, part of God's very good creation. And watch this, if death is not the payment for sin, then Jesus' death cannot and does not pay our sin debt. And we just destroy the foundation for Christ's atoning work on the cross, whether we meant to or not, and at best made that event in history unnecessary. And can I let you in on a little secret? Guys, this is why we care so much about these issues. Our passion, my passion personally, our passion as a ministry, is not about winning a debate per se about the age of the earth, the rock, layers of fossils, but rather defending biblical authority and the gospel rooted in that authority, because that is what's at stake, that is what's under attack, and that's why this matters so much. Because bottom line is this, the gospel of Jesus Christ does not start in the book of Matthew. It starts in the book of Genesis. It truly does. And someone would say, okay, Brian, well, that makes sense, but then wait a minute. Are you telling me that if I don't believe in a young earth, so-called 6,000-year-old earth, and a global flood, and a literal Adam, that I can't be a Christian? Is that what you're saying? Is this a direct salvation issue? Not at all. What's the Bible say about salvation? John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him and a young earth and a global flood, they will be saved. No, that's from second heresies or third opinions, okay? That's not in the Bible. If that's in your Bible, throw that Bible away. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone, plus nothing. So this is not a direct salvation issue, but it is an indirect salvation issue, because where does the message of salvation through Christ come from? It comes from the Word of God. And again, if you can't trust this part over here, why trust the rest? And that's why it is so important and relevant that we are obedient to God's command. Here in other places like Jude 1:3, many others, to give an answer for our faith. I think so many Christians haven't done this because we've bought multiple secular lies. One of those lies is this. Well, you can't use the Bible to do science because the Bible's not a science textbook. Our response is, you're right, it's not, and praise God. Those change every year. Right? But where the Bible touches on science, we can trust it because it is the infallible, inerrant word of the living God who's omniscient, knows all things, perfect in wisdom. He cannot lie. We can trust all that it says about everything, past, present, and future, because it comes from God himself. But here's what the Bible does for us. The Bible gives us the big picture of history to rightly understand things like biology, geology, anthropology. It gives us the right understanding of the past that we apply to the evidence in the present. And that's really important because we all live in the present. Right? Right? How many of you are living with me in the present right now? Just checking. All right, very good. And think about it like this. You know, if you ask the question, when do fossils exist? Well, fossils exist in the present. If they did not exist in the present, we would not have them. And you got to think about it. When we find a bone in the dirt, bones don't come with labels on them saying, hey, I'm 65 million years old, made in China. Or whatever, okay? And guys, here's the point. All the evidence any scientist has, a biblical scientist, a secular scientist, they've got all the same stuff in the present. The same rock layers and the same fossils and the same radioisotopes, the same distant starlight, all observed in the present. But here's the key. They interpret those things differently in the present and make different guesses about where those things came from, their origin, and thus their age. Based on their different starting assumptions about the unseen past based from a human perspective, based in their different worldviews. And here's the key, simple yet profound. If you start with the wrong assumptions, especially about unseen history, you'll likely get the wrong conclusions. And this is why some really brilliant secular scientists can be so wrong about particular things like the age of the earth and rock layers and fossils, etc. Wrong assumptions, wrong conclusions. Reminded of the story of an elderly gentleman who was just sure his wife was going deaf. So one night he snuck up behind her about 10 feet away and he whispered, can you hear me, honey? He heard nothing. He got a few feet closer. Can you hear me, honey? Nothing. He got right behind her. Can you hear me, honey? To which she responded, for the third time, yes. It's silly, but you get the idea, right? Wasn't her problem. Wrong assumptions, wrong conclusions. You got to keep that thought in mind as we go through all these different topics in the coming sessions. It really is a foundational worldview issue. And we must realize this, another secular lie. Guys, there is no such thing as neutrality. Neutrality does not exist. Either God's word is your authority or it's not. On every issue, morality, origins, sexuality, salvation, either this is your foundation and you build your thinking from here, or if you reject this, then man's ideas, really your own thinking, has become your ultimate authority. There is no neutrality. The Bible is very clear on this. Christ said, either you're with me or against me. Either you gather with me or you scatter. Either you walk in light or you walk in darkness. It's clear from God's word that the mindset on the flesh, it's not neutral towards God. It's at hostility towards God. There is no such thing as neutrality. And realizing that truth, then we stand on God's word boldly, lovingly, uncompromisingly. And as we stand on God's word, an amazing thing happens. Guys, we have answers to all sorts of questions, and the answers aren't that hard. Just trust the Bible. You can defend your faith and use that to get to the gospel. You can answer questions like this one, scaring Christians half to death for over a century now. If the Bible is true, then how did Noah get all those animals onto the ark? Hear this question all the time. If you just trust the Bible, the answer is really not that hard. First, the Bible is very clear. The ark was a huge boat, over 500 feet long, a football field and a half in length over that, actually, 85 feet wide and 50 feet tall with three different levels, literally a floating warehouse. When you go to the ark encounter, wear good walking shoes. You're going to need them. It's a lot of ground to cover. It's a lot of big boat, a lot of square space. It's a big ship. Guys, this was not Noah's ark. If you see a picture like this in one of your kids' books, do me a favor and blow it up. Get rid of it, right? And then how did he get the animals onto the ark? Well, the Bible's very clear. Noah took two of each kind onto the ark. Not two of each species, two of each kind. And the word kind in the Bible, for the most part, it's equal to about the family level of modern-day classification. So what that means is this. Noah did not take 400 pairs of dogs on the ark. All right? He most likely never saw a chihuahua or poodle in his life. He was a blessed man. He took two of the dog kind, two of the elephant kind, two of the cat kind, et cetera, to the major kinds of the land-dwelling, air-breathing animals, and they fit with no problem on that massive boat. And then we should be connecting the flood to geology. If there was a global flood as described in God's word, we would expect to find billions of dead things buried in rock layers, laid down by water all over the earth. And guess what we find? Billions of dead things buried in rock layers, laid down by water all over the earth. Tremendous confirmation of the Bible's historicity. And someone will say, but wait, I thought it took a long time to make a rock layer. Not at all. Water, dirt, minerals, right conditions, you can make rock layers in really quickly. A few examples recently from nature. Here's a ship's bell encased by rock. Here's an ancient clock in a rock. There's a spark plug in a rock. Those things are, of course, not millions of years old. Or you might remember Mount St. Helens erupting back in 1980. From that minor eruption by historical standards, it produced rock layers, hundreds of rock layers, huge rock layers, laminated rock layers, tiny ones, and everything in between. It produced these rock layers, get this, in literally hours. We just watched it happen right in front of our eyes. It produced canyons like this one, nicknamed the Mini Grand Canyon because it's 1/40th the size of the Grand Canyon, with similar features to the Grand Canyon. Very steep walls, side barbed canyons, very little debris at the bottom of this canyon. And guys, it formed this canyon in 9 hours. We just watched it happen right in front of us. Great observable, testable, repeatable evidence. It doesn't take a long time to make those sort of structures. What you do need is a catastrophe. And if you want bigger rock layers and bigger canyons, you'll need a bigger catastrophe, maybe like a global flood described in God's word. And some say, okay, but then what about the fossils in those rock layers? I thought fossils took a long time to form. Actually, no, to make a fossil is typically a rapid process. You got to bury something deeply and quickly to protect it from scavengers and decomposition. A few examples of this rapid process. Here's a petrified ham. A ham that turned to stone in less than 60 years after being buried from a volcanic eruption. A petrified ham. What do you do with it? No one knows. But there it is, a petrified ham. Here's a fish fossilized in the act of eating another fish. This is actually a common occurrence. Fishes eating other fish. It's like a snapshot in time, frozen in time. Fish in another fish's belly, still whole, hasn't been digested yet. See this all the time throughout the fossil record. But this poor guy did not get to finish his last meal. And that's why I call this fossil the Last Supper. Maybe not appropriate. Okay, very good. It's an ichthyosaur fossilized in the act of giving birth, which again, that's an instantaneous snapshot in time, not a slow process. Recently, scientists made fossils in a laboratory. They made these fossils in 24 hours with heat and pressure and water. And the fossils they made look pretty much identical to fossils you'll find out in nature. And speaking of a recent deposition or formation of these fossils, we are finding literally all over the world. In pretty much all the rock layers, we're finding soft tissue from dinosaurs still intact in their bones. The tissue is still literally stretchy and pliable like our flesh. Many times, there are blood vessels and red blood cells still intact in that tissue. And those organic remnants should not last hundreds of years after the creature's death. Maybe thousands of special conditions like post a flood, no way millions. Great confirmation of the biblical time scale. We could literally just go on with these examples, but here's the point for this morning. When you start with the Bible and have a biblical worldview, we've got answers. And guys, real science, real geology, real anthropology, real astronomy will confirm the Bible again and again and again if you just trust God's word. And someone will say, okay, well, that really seems to make sense, but then wait, Brian, if science so strongly confirms the Bible, then how come so many smart people today miss such clear evidence that confirms the Bible? It's a good question. And the Bible gives the answer. Because ultimately, all these things, it's not a head issue. It is a heart issue that becomes a worldview issue as a result. It's not an intellect issue. It's a battle over the heart. What do we mean by heart? Not feelings. It's a battle over the will. Because every one of us has one of two options in this life. They are this. Either God is God, his authority, we're not. His word's the authority, ours is not. We submit to it. Option two, reject God. And then man's ideas, really your own thinking becomes your own ultimate authority. And that's the battle of the heart. And what we've seen in our culture has been this foundational battle between two different worldviews, the two foundational religions of our day and age, the two foundational religions of history, the battle between God's word and man's. And there's been this foundational shift in our culture from God's word to man's as the ultimate authority. Man now determines truth in so many different radical ways. And we now have multiple generations trained up in our culture who no longer build our thinking on God's word as the authority. Multiple generations who think like that, both outside the church and also inside the church because of so much generational compromise on these issues. So what do we do about it? Good question. Glad you asked it. We'll sum up with these little castle diagrams. Castle on the right represents Christianity, built on the foundation of the God's word and the biblical doctrines that come from that foundation, the gospel itself. Castle on the left represents secular humanism, the idea that man can determine truth and the moral relativism that comes from that worldview that dominates our cultural landscape today. Notice a couple observations I think are accurate from the picture. First, notice the humanists. That's, by the way, the dominant religion of our culture. Notice the humanists who are driven by the enemy, whether they realize it or not. They're being very clever today. Don't focus your attacks on things like the deity of Christ and the virgin birth of Christ and the resurrection. They'll attack those things, but don't focus there. No, attack the foundation. Focus your attack on that foundational history in the book of Genesis. Because they understand that once that foundation goes, what will happen to the structure? It's going to fall. And then notice the Christians. You might recognize some of these people. Some have no idea what's going on. Or they're asleep. Some are fighting over typically trivial things like what color should the carpet be, which hymnal to use. How should you brew the coffee in the church, dark or light? The answer is obvious, dark. Why are we talking about that? And then you have some who are here, and by the way, for full disclosure, I was here for a while myself in my Christian walk, and many Christians today who say, we don't need evolution, we don't need the Bible, we don't need Genesis 1-11 to explain history. Maybe God used evolution millions of years. No big deal, just trust in Jesus. And they're actually destroying their own foundation, whether they realize it or not. And by the way, you see the guy, if you look really closely in this picture, he's got on a suit and a tie. Why? Because he represents the majority of our pastors, Bible college professors, or seminary professors who are compromised to one degree or another on these issues, training the coming generations to be compromised as well. And I think the rest of us, we resonate with this guy right here. We look out into our culture and we see all these social ills, and we think to ourselves, well, we got to fight against these things. And we do need to fight against those things. That's truth. We fight against those things in truth and in love. You do God's will God's way. So we fight in truth and love. But friends, as we fight, let us realize this fundamental truth. Those things are not the problem. They're the symptoms. They're the symptoms of a loss of biblical authority in our culture today, starting in the church in many cases. And for all of our time and effort fighting these symptoms in our culture, is it working? What's the answer? We're becoming less Christian every day. Why isn't it working? Well, because in a real sense, we've been playing checkers. The enemy's been playing chess. We've been fighting symptoms. He's been attacking the foundation of our faith and the faith of our children. You see, when you just deal with the symptoms and ignore the foundational stuff, in a real sense, all you're trying to do is just change the culture to make it more Christianized. But God's word doesn't say to Christianize a culture. The Bible says go into the world and to preach the gospel and to make disciples. That God will change people from the inside out through his word, through the gospel. That'll change their thinking. That'll change their worldview. That can change a culture. Cultures change because of the gospel. You see, we are losing this quote-unquote culture war because we are fighting the symptoms and not the source. So what is the solution? In a word, stand. Stand. If we will stand on God's word, equip ourselves, our kids, our grandkids, our students to know what we believe and why, to defend the faith by standing on God's word, is then we can give answers that deal with the issues of our day, but also the source of the problem as well, that biblical authority issue. And we can defend our faith, and we can use that defense to get to the answer, which is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because make no mistake about this, the answer to the problems of our culture is the gospel. Amen? Always has been the answer, always will be the answer. But that gospel stands on the authority of the word of the living God, which starts in the book of Genesis. And again, that is why we're so zealous about this, because we're zealous about God, his glory, and the authority of his word. That's really what all of this is about. And guys, that is your introduction. It's a long one. But that's your introduction to why all the answers we'll get to really do matter so much in our day and age. And a huge part of our ministry is not merely declaring these answers. I love teaching them. It's such a blessing to do so. But we want you to be equipped to have these answers yourself, to pass them on to your kids, your grandkids, to share them in the workspace, in the schools, in the college setting, wherever you're at Walmart, Starbucks, wherever, to give these answers. And so we're about equipping people to know and defend the faith. A few things I'd highly recommend, the website answersofgenesis.org. That's our website. There are literally thousands of free articles and videos for all age groups, giving them all sorts of answers that you can use to defend your faith on pretty much any question you can imagine, all free on the website. Be sure you save that, bookmark that, use that repetitively. Great resource. And then we've brought a whole bunch of books and DVDs with us out there in the lobby area. A few things I highly recommend based on this session. First, the book The Lie is the foundational textbook built on God's Word, of course, for our ministry. It's basically what you just heard in book form, an expanded forms. If you want more on this idea, why it matters, get that book. You want to share these ideas through a book, that's the book to get and to share. And then a couple of new books by Ken, our founder, come out recently, great on this issue, kind of using those principles and dealing with some teaching how to really equip our kids to deal with this. First, the book Will They Stand Facing the Giants? And so equipping our kids to stand in this secular day and age with this biblical worldview intact, great book for them. And probably Ken's newest book, A Divided Nation. Really applying the principles you heard this morning to what's happening in our culture today and how we can rightly respond biblically. Great book on that issue. Again, summary of what you heard today in that book as well. For the answers themselves, the answers books 1-4 are phenomenal. And I know I'm biased. I work for the ministry. I get that, all right? But they really are incredible. Each book answers around 30 different questions. Each chapter in the book is a different question. So you can read the chapters out of order. Great reference tool. There are study guides to download with the books. Can be used for homeschooling, a Bible study, whatever. Great resources. I encourage you to check those out. And then this book. I really like this book. It's called Quick Answers to Tough Questions. I like this book so much because it is my book, okay? Let me be transparent on that, but I wrote the majority of it. Bodhi had some to do with it as well, but it's basically the idea is to give you quick, concise answers to the issues of our day. Each answer is less than 500 words, so it's very ADD friendly, okay? and 33 different answers to questions like, what about dinosaurs in the Bible, the age of the earth, carbon-14 dating, who did Cain marry, stuff like that, dealing with these scientific origin questions, short, snappy answers. And then tomorrow's night talk is based on this book, where I give a talk by the same title, Quick Answers to Social Issues. In this book, I give 37 biblical answers to the social issues of our day. What about, how do we respond to abortion and euthanasia, stem cell research? What about social justice? Is it biblical? Short answer, no, but we can talk more about that later on. What about the idea of climate change? What about the green movement? What about homosexuality and the transgender movement? How do we respond to all those things? Short, concise, biblical answers to all those sorts of questions in that book. And the books like The 10-Minute Bible Journey, great personal devotion or family devotion, walking through the Bible chronologically, so well done. Books that dive a bit deeper, like Glass House, kind of attacking the icons of evolution, give you good rebuttals to all those things. Or books, we'll talk more about this tomorrow night, One Blood, One Race, dealing with the issue of racism from a biblical perspective, and so much other stuff. We've got stuff for kids. I will say this about the kids' books. These are fun. The answers for kids, they're real questions from real kids with a paragraph answer. And the answer is meaty enough to where the parents will get a lot from it too, but the kids can understand it. So it benefits both the parent and the kid or the grandparent as you read it with them. It's a great resource for that and numerous other reasons. So many of the books back there in the back, you can check them all in the lobby behind us later on. Great resources, no bathtub arcs, real arcs, engaging artwork, good for kids. We got DVDs that are good for the teens and ADD adults out there. We've got you covered, all right, all this stuff. This one's kind of like what you heard today, the genesis of the gospel, so many other things. Take advantage of what's called the You Choose Special during the conference. Basically, any combination of books or DVDs out there on the tables for those prices. And it's great, we get a lot of stuff to be equipped to defend your faith. And then just a couple last things that we wrap up here. The Answers Magazine, got to mention this, comes out quarterly. It's so well done. Deals with current issues from a biblical worldview perspective. Has a kids magazine in it that kids love. Scientifically proven by my son, who was reading at 15 months because he is advanced. Actually, he was not reading, but it was funny. He does like to read now. He's 7 now. Just literally, last night, I walked in. He was taking a shower in our bathroom, and we have a glass frame around our shower, and there's a little ledge outside of it. He had taken a book, opened it up, put it against the glass. He was reading the book as he was taking a shower. It's cracking me up. But anyway, he does like to read now. But the magazine is phenomenal. You can check that out. Get a digital version with that. And for every year, subscribe to the magazine. You get a free DVD up to 3, which is all a great deal. And check all that out with the book tables. Then there's a newsletter. You sign up for that either via mail or email. Keep up with us as a ministry. And then Answers.tv. It's our own streaming platform, kind of like Disney Plus or Netflix. But this one is much better because it's biblical and safe for the entire family. And it's so well done. We have over 4,000 videos already downloaded to the platform. So much great stuff. Partner with ministries like Todd Friel, Wretched Radio, Ray Comfort, Living Waters, many others. You can check all that out. And it's only $40 for the entire year, which is like $3.33 a month. That's a lot cheaper than Netflix and a lot better, I would argue. And then I'll wrap up with saying this. Guys, the point of all this stuff, as we said this morning, this introduction, is to equip us to stand on God's word, to defend the faith, to proclaim the gospel in an effective way. In a real sense, in summary, we want to use answers to get to the answer, Jesus Christ. That's the hope and heartbeat behind all of this. Let me close this with prayer, and I'll hand it off. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for today. We thank you for your word and your truth. We thank you, Lord, for the trustworthiness of your word. We thank you, Lord, that you have left us a sure word that is right about everything. Help us, Lord, to maybe see if we have been compromising, unwittingly maybe, your word. Let us repent of that, wherever that might be. Let us stand firmly on the foundation that is your word. Let us trust your word. Let us build our thinking from that foundation on every area. And let us stand boldly on the rock that is your word to be the salt and light you have called us to be. Not to win arguments, not to look smart, not to win debates, but, Lord, to be obedient to your command because we love you, we want to honor you and glorify you. And we know as we obey you that you'll work through us, through your word and through your gospel, to do your will. That'll be awesome for now and for eternity. God, may we stand firm, may we be the light you've called us to be. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, sir.
We have Brian to take a hand for his presentation. Thank you. I'm excited for tonight. I don't know how you cover that much content in such a short amount of time, but I hope you'll come back tonight. We're going to end our service by worshiping our Creator, Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's stand up and worship Him, and then we'll be dismissed.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Dismissed.